Scripture reading is Galatians 3:25-29. But after faith has come, we are no longer under a tutor. For you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise.
Morning! So I really like cartoons, but I do watch some movies that aren't cartoons. I know, you'll have to forgive me for that one. I think all movies that aren't cartoons are bad. So I apologize, I do have a dark side. So I was watching this movie, it's called Star Wars. And I don't know if you've ever got the point of Star Wars is completely opposite of everything you think of. You think about it, you have these great men, these powerful empire. These great rulers, this great authority, they have the money, they have the power, they're these Sith lords, these strong, mighty men. And then you have these rebels. These rebels are poor, and generally everything they're driving is broken down, and they've rebuilt, and they've stolen most of everything they have. And they're terrible, and they generally have nothing. And we look at that and, you know, we really get behind Star Wars and we're like, this is a great story. And yet, in our everyday life, we always think the opposite. We always think the opposite. We're like, the Empire, that's the good guys. Those who are, you know, powerful and strong, the rulers, the mighty, these are the good guys. And the reality is, the Bible is closer to Star Wars than our culture. It's closer to saying, you know those rebels? You know those men with nothing? You know those people who, you know, they're doing the best they can. You know those guys who everything breaks down on them. You know those guys who have very few numbers. You know those guys who are facing the world. Who are facing the power of the world. Those are the good guys. And today I want you to think along those lines of Star Wars and think how God views our world. Because he looks to those rebels. He looks to those outcasts. He looks to those downtrodden and he says, these are the good guys. These are the ones fighting for good. And today we have a story. We're in Mark chapter 5. We'll be starting in verse 21. And I want you to hear about some woman. I mean, there's Jairus. Let me tell you about Jairus. Jairus is great. He's the ruler of the synagogue. You know he's got money. Because for you to be able to afford, before they put it in this little cute little book, you know, one of those fancy scrolls where you can get up there and you can actually study the Bible, because that's the purpose of synagogue, is great Bible study, is before they could put it in these little books and print it real cheap, they had these giant scrolls that were super expensive. And these scrolls had to go in these closets, and these closets had to be made of gold. And you can see how a synagogue could get really expensive. And Jairus has money. And he's a ruler of the synagogue. And so he has this authority. And let me tell you one other thing about him that's very important to y'all. And y'all love this fact. He's a guy. I don't know if the fact that I was saying he made you get that, but he's actually a guy. I don't think it ever says he is a guy. But assume he's a guy from the fact it says he. So we are in Mark chapter 5, and we are starting in verse 21. And we start off with Jairus, this empire character, this dark lord, this evil. Mark 5, verse 21. And when Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered around him, and he was beside the sea. Then came one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name, he has a name too. And seeing him, he fell at his feet and implored him earnestly, saying, my little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her so that she may be made well and live. And he went with him. So we start off with our first character. Our first character is named who? Jairus. Our second character is named what? Nothing. Good job. I'll just fill in the blanks without even trying. Now you have to, I want you to get this. This is our normal. This is a ruler of the synagogue. This is a religious authority. I want you to get forget who this is. This is Jairus by name. And in the middle of this story, he breaks it. And we see a character of great faith. 24. And a great crowd followed him and thronged about him. And there was a woman. What was her name? Good job. I didn't think of this. And there was a woman who had a discharge of blood for 12 years. And who had suffered much under many physicians. And had spent all that she had and was no better. But rather grew worse. And she had heard the reports about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his garment. For she said, if I touch even his garment, I will be made well. And immediately the flow of blood dried up and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. And Jesus, perceiving in himself that power had gone out from him, immediately turned about in the crowd and said, who touched my garments? And his disciples said to him, you see the crowd pressing around you, and yet you say, who touched me? And he looked around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling, fell down before him and told him the whole truth. And he said to her, daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace. Be healed of your disease. I want you to get this one. This one we've got the side of faith, but let's start with she's a woman. We get that from the fact that her name is a woman. She's poor. We're going from riches to rags. Completely rags on this side. And we've got one more. She's not only poor, not only a woman, she's diseased. And you may not remember what you're supposed to do with the diseased. Put your hand over your lip. We're going to try this. We can learn the Bible. This is in the Bible. Don't worry. Try it. It'll work. It's in the Bible. I didn't write the Bible. Come on, you go like this. I'm not kidding. You put your hand over your lip and you say, unclean. That way it'll spit on me when I say it. And I walk around and I go, unclean, unclean. So you know to go to the other side and I don't spit on you. That's what the hand's for. It's for your safety, not mine. Because those neat little masks they have for the sick didn't exist, so you used your hand. And then obviously it's all over their hand. That sickness. And so even more reason to avoid these people. And this diseased woman who is spitting on her hand constantly goes up and touches the garments of Jesus. Because she has the faith to go up to Jesus as unclean and as low as she is. Because she believes that if she touches those garments, she can make well. Though she has suffered in this life, though she has suffered under physicians, and she has tried to be healed over and over. And you know that has to be done in faith. When she's going, you know, I'll go to this doctor and see what they can do. Okay, that didn't work. So go to this doctor and see what they can do. And what does it say? She runs out of money. She went from having some money to she is broke because of her disease. She is outcast because of her disease. And she touches Jesus and Jesus says, daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace. Be healed of your disease. Amen. Let's continue with this ruler of the synagogue. I mean, let's see what Jesus has to say about this ruler of the synagogue. While he was still speaking, there came from the ruler's house some who said, your daughter's dead. Why trouble the teacher any further? But Jesus, overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the ruler of the synagogue, do not fear. Only believe. And he allowed no one to follow him except Peter and James and John, the brother of James. They came to the house of the ruler of the synagogue. And Jesus saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing, laughing. And when he had entered, he said to them, why are you making a commotion and weeping? The child is not dead, but sleeping. And they laughed at him. But he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him. And went in with where the child was. Taking her by the hand, he said to her, Talitha kumi, which means little girl, I say to you, arise. And immediately the girl got up and began walking. For she was 12 years of age, and they were immediately overcome with amazement. And he strictly charged them that no one should know this, and told them to give her something to eat. Now we have two characters, and I want you to see it. And one is a model of faith. And one of them is a model of the synagogue. And this woman, who has no good reason to have faith left, the one who suffered under different people, who has this faith in Christ to risk it all, to risk Jesus becoming unclean, to risk going out in a crowd where she's not allowed, to risk the ridicule and the mocking that she's going to receive, to risk all these things, she's willing to risk it all and have the kind of faith to reach out and grab his garment, to touch one of those tassels, touch one of those tassels that represents one of the tribes of Israel, that those tassels that hang down at the bottom of every teacher. And she goes and she touches one of those, a sign of complete disrespect. But she had enough faith that if she touched it, she would be healed. And then you go to Jairus. And what does he have to say? Obviously, he's a ruler of the synagogue. Jesus walks in and he goes, I know you already believe. You're okay. I know you're ready. I know you believe that this is going to happen. I don't got to question your faith. You're ready to go. You know, I was reading through it. That's not exactly what I read, but y'all can read that. It's awesome. Verse 36, Jesus said to the ruler of the synagogue, let me tell you how great he is. He's the ruler of the synagogue. Let me tell you how great he is a second time. Do not fear. Only believe. He calls him out for this and he says, do not fear. Why would he say that? Because he has fear. Why would he challenge him to believe if he doesn't already believe? And so you have this, and you're challenged today, and the challenge is this. Do you look at outward appearances? Are you convinced what you are? Because I want to tell you about this woman. I love the fact that her name is a woman. Because how many times do we let somebody say, you are a? And they say, who are you? I always hated the question, who are you? Because you don't know what it means. You don't know what they're even asking. Who are you? I'm of the Benefield clan. Where am I? Who are you? Are you asking what I do for a living? I don't know. Are you asking, am I married? Yes, I'm a husband. Are you asking if I'm a daddy? Yes, I am. And so you say, who are you? But in this story, this woman is nothing. She is just a woman. No name, no nothing. At least the Syrophoenician woman, who's also a model of faith in the scripture, at least you know where she came from. We know nothing about her. We know nothing where she came from. She is nobody, and the Bible makes sure we know that she is nobody. And the only thing they use to describe her is such a great insult to all the Jews and the synagogue as a whole. The synagogue is one of those places that women didn't really need to go. Everything you can read about the synagogue, you're going to realize what it was. It's where men get together and study the Bible. That's it. It doesn't do anything for anyone. It doesn't involve everything we made the synagogue to be. The synagogue was just men getting together and studying the Bible. There was very little reason for a woman to actually go to synagogue. They didn't need to know the Bible. They didn't need to learn scripture. I mean, why would they? There was some male in the Jewish family who could always teach them. There was some male who could, you know, tell them what the right decision was. They didn't need to go. So you have this huge contrast between synagogue, which is a nasty word to me, and someone. And you have this power and this authority and all this. And you know what's weird? We look at it and we would say, you know what? If I want to go find faith, I'm going to go to the ruler of the synagogue. Somebody who's dedicated their lives, somebody who's dedicated their wealth, somebody who has lived the synagogue rules. Somebody who goes and says, you know what? I followed all those extra rules. I got them down pat. I'm going to go find my faith right there. And what did we find? When Jesus comes to him and somebody goes, hey, daughter's dead. Jesus has to at this point say, don't fear. Don't be afraid. Believe. But did you notice he never says anything like that to the woman? When he talks about the woman, he doesn't say anything. He doesn't go up to her and go, believe that this will work. He hasn't said a word to her. He hasn't even noticed her. It's specifically says,
"Who touched me?"
He hasn't noticed her. It's not that he was looking at her, already talking to her. It's not that he had gone by and given her that special look where she's, he's like, "Yeah, you got this. You know, you can do this." A little pep talk with the eyes.
Your mamas know how to do it, don't worry. Guys have no concept of what I'm talking about.
But you know what I'm talking about? It's not that there was any communication with her. It was that there was this faith that needed nothing. This faith that said, "I believe I am a woman. Nothing more is recorded of me. And yet I have the faith that if I touch this garment, I defy everything those rules." Remember the synagogue?
This is not a Bible. I want you to know that. I realize you can't read that from here unless you're amazing. Some of you can read this. This is what we call the prayer book. Jewish prayer book. Jews know that book better than they do the Torah. Oh, they know a lot better than they know the Torah. They have these prayers memorized for every event, for every different thing. If I go eat food, I've got different lessons I've got to remember. I don't want to thank God for grain if I'm eating fruit. I want to thank God for the trees if I'm eating fruit. Now, if I'm eating fruit that doesn't come from a tree, I've also got a different prayer for that. This book is packed full of things I'm supposed to say. It takes me like 5 prayers to get to lunch. Because I've got to thank you for the bread specifically. I've got to thank you for the meat, whatever it is. I've got to thank him, not for cheese, because you can't mix milk and meat. I've got to thank him for any vegetables that are on my plate. I've got to thank you for the plate. I've got a special blessing for those who prepared it. I mean, this is this rule guy, and all it is he is good at keeping the rules. He's the ruler of the synagogue, and this woman is good at breaking rules. How hard would it be to walk on the opposite side of the street of someone? This is Stretch Armstrong business here, right here. She's walking on the opposite side of the street, avoiding a crowd because she's following the rules and she knows what to do. And she walks on the opposite side of the street, and she reaches across the street. Her arm stretches out like 12 feet. And she reaches out and she touches the hem of the garment. How many of y'all think that's what happened? Okay, good, because it's not. This isn't about Stretch Armstrong. This is the story of her going in a crowd. She's not supposed to be in that crowd. Not just because she's unclean, but because she is a woman. She shouldn't be bumping up against men. She shouldn't be in that crowd in the first place. And these disciples, note how many are pressing around. I mean, so she is in the midst of this crowd. Do you want somebody with an infectious disease walking in the middle of a crowd? Just breathing on everyone? But this is this woman for you who defies every rule, and she goes in and she touches the hem of garment, and Jesus pointed out, right? He said, "You know what? You didn't get all them rules, right? You know what? We have a rule here and you didn't follow it. There's a corner with a cone. Go for it." And it doesn't say, Jesus doesn't point out, "Well, you know, you didn't get it all those rules perfectly. You didn't do everything like you were supposed to." He comes to her and he says, "Your faith." Amen. And this woman who fails the rules is poor, not even a man. None of the things that Jairus was. And Mark, through the inspiration of God, puts this in a sandwich. You're going to figure out that Mark doesn't write in order. He's kind of a weird writer to us because we like things in order. He's never in order. He just throws things together as he sees them fit. And the idea here is you start with Jairus. You start with this ruler. You start with our image. We start with what we view our society as. And who we view as those who represent God. And he starts with those religious people. And he ends with those religious people. And in the contrast you see in the sandwich, you go, the sandwich is where the good stuff is. You get bread at the beginning, bread at the end, and meat in the middle. It's called a sandwich, and it's a great way of teaching. And what it teaches here is this. You started with Jairus, you end with Jairus. But the meat was this. Some woman. Her faith was great enough that Jesus convinced her faith. Do you know that Jesus never commends a religious person's faith? It's just not in Scripture. Do you know that he commends faith multiple times? None of them are religious. Here's one of them. You're going to find out when he's going to commend faith. He's going to talk to a Syrophoenician woman. Faith. He's even going to say the line specifically, faith like yours has no one been found in Israel. No one in Israel has a faith like you do. Specifically saying you're not even Jewish and you've got better faith than they do. And yet today we've got our images and we've got our views of things and we've got our ideas of what people have to be. And here's the thing. Here's what we look at. We say, oh, I saw a woman. And I love the invitation. This invitation is for all three. Galatians 3. Galatians 3. But now that faith has come, we are no longer under a garment. For in Christ Jesus, you are all sons of God. Through faith, for as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. Amen?
Amen.
There is neither Jew nor Greek. Amen? There is neither slave nor free. Amen? There is neither male nor female. Amen? For you are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs, according to the promise. Today, there's an invitation, one, to just challenge our thinking. To look at people anew. To look past those things that we think, or view, or predict. And say, you know what, Jairus didn't have that good of faith. I don't want Jairus' faith. I don't want all that religiosity, that business stuff. I want the faith of a woman who's willing to do anything to get to her Jesus. And to look at our world instead and see it as people who are desiring God. And stop condemning for any of these things that are put away. I don't care what race you are. I know some of us are racist. Don't lie. This is West Virginia. It's as bad as Oklahoma. Don't worry. There's some of us who have it. And we need to get over it. And it's fair. There are some of us who view money as a standard. Who view money as making people important. And we need to get past it. We need to get over it. It's through. There are some of us who are sexist. And we are so convinced guys are better. And we need to get over it. And we need to look at this and do what he says. We are all the number one. We are all one in Christ. So today you have the invitation to just change your thinking. But there's in this invitation that call that we are one in Christ. And there's that invitation to be in Christ. To believe that Jesus is Lord. To confess him as Lord. Repent of your sins. Be buried with Christ. So you're raised up in Christ as one. So that you can then live for Christ. There's also the invitation that you've got sin in your life that's keeping you from fully serving God. And it's sin that's keeping you away. And it's, you know, your struggles, your issues. And you haven't given them to God. And they're that barrier. That barrier that says, I'm not going to touch the hem of Jesus. I'm not worthy. And maybe you need prayers. And you're struggling. And lastly, if there's anybody who wishes to submit to the eldership here, we offer all these as we stand and as we sing.